Edeline leave, and I would like to thank Fenwick of Bondsbury and AWITA for co-hosting the second of our monthly Women and Power speaker series this evening. As many of you already know, my autumn-winter 2019 collection was an homage to Mary Beard's Women and Power, discussing the cultural underpinnings of misogyny. In an attempt to portray true power on the fashion stage, we had 35 prominent women of many disciplines orate throughout my presentation at London Fashion Week. You can watch the video on YouTube. It was truly one of the most life-affirming and inspirational experiences of my career. Mary Beard said, "The mental cultural template for a powerful person remains resolutely male." She speaks about Googling cartoon professors and coming up with hundreds of images and only one female professor. As a society, she continues, we have no template for what a powerful woman looks like, except that she looks rather like a man. As a designer, I find my purpose in this very conundrum. How does true feminine power dress? How does she feel? What is beautiful, useful, practical in the life that she leads? The women of the art world were the first community to understand and support my brand when I first began. Therefore, I am so excited tonight to welcome Sigrid Kirk for AWITA and our panel on the topic of dressed for the art world.
Thank you, Edeline. As you know, I've been wearing your clothes for about 10 years now, and you're a dear friend, so when this opportunity came up, we jumped at it. Welcome, everyone. Thank you on behalf of Kate, Katrina, and I. This is a wonderful event to close AWITA's 2019 season with, and it's particularly apt, given that we're all going to be really focusing on dressing for so many Christmas parties. The kind of issue of what to wear in the art world was something we've been tossing around as on our committee for some time, but we were sort of always worried that it would feel frivolous. And of course, we're not frivolous women, and we don't work with frivolous women. For those of you who don't know, the Association of Women in the Arts was formed 3 years ago to support professional women working in the visual arts through mentoring, professional development, and networking. And it's wonderful to have so many of you here today. Caring about clothing and how it affects our image, power, and style is, of course, not irreconcilable with our working lives in the art world. We work in a visually dominant sector, but that can also bring its issues. So I think this is going to be a fascinating conversation, exploring image and power. Does clothing give us confidence, or is it our armor? Fashion is a personal brand. Do you consciously or unconsciously adopt a style? The ethical and political messaging of fashion, gendered fashion, class hierarchies in fashion, as well as practical considerations for travelling, how to pack for an art fair. And I know we have a couple of our panellists here today who've literally just hopped off a plane, so I'm sure we're going to get some fantastic practical tips. I'd like to introduce our panel and our moderator, Helena Lee, who's the Features Director of Harper's Bazaar. Thank you, Helena. Helena also edits the annual magazine Bazaar Art, which celebrates women in the arts. In 2018, she launched Bazaar Art Week and is responsible for its programming. Next, Nazy, Vassegh, who's on our AWITA Executive Committee, a very valuable member of that. She's also the founder and CEO of Eye of the Collector, the next generation alternative to a traditional art fair, which will be launching in 2020. She's also an art advisor and strategic consultant. Linsey Young is curator of contemporary art Tate Britain, and she's also the curator of Scotland at Venice. Thank you, Linsey, for being here. Indre, Serpytyte is a Lithuanian artist who works across many media, film, photography, sculpture, and her practice explores issues around history, memory, and culture. You studied at the Royal College of Art, Indre, and she's been exhibited at Tate Modern, the Venice Biennale, among other international organisations. Last but not least, Polly. Thank you, Polly. I know you're very much feeling a little bit jet lagged today.
Holly is executive director of Thaddaeus Ropac Gallery with over 30 years of experience in the art world. Holly started her career at Anton Joffe Gallery, and then she established and ran her own niche art advisory business, and joined Thaddaeus Ropac's flagship gallery 4 years ago. So we have women from all parts of the art ecology, and that's what we wanted to have today. We want to have very many different voices. So without further ado, I'll pass you over to Helena. Thank you.
Thanks, Sigrid. I'm absolutely delighted to be navigating the complex world of image, power, and personal style in the art world with these illustrious ladies at the helm. I couldn't be more thrilled to gain insights from you all. I wanted to begin with a passage from Mary Beard, who wrote for Harper's Bazaar, and I asked her to examine the relationship between fashion and power dressing and give us some takeouts on these wise Romans. And she wrote that people in the ancient world saw style and choice of dress as an important marker of who you were within your own society and what influence you had. There was much discussion about the way Julius Caesar dressed, the way he combed his hair forward, Trump style, to cover up his bald patch. And according to one Roman writer, the strongest clue he was not to be trusted was the way his toga hung too loosely. So it really does show two things, that clothes do matter and that things never change. So with that in mind, I wanted to ask each of you about the clothes you choose to wear. You know, have you consciously thought about your personal style and do you use it to build an image? So, Nazy, perhaps I could start with you because there's much variance in what you do. You know, in one day, you might have to face clients and artists before going to a dinner or an event. You're about to launch your own art fair, Art Eye of the Collector. What do you want to achieve with your wardrobe?
Well, as you rightly say, I do have a very varied day. No day is the same. So I might wake up and have to go to an artist's studio in the morning, then have some meetings, lunch, and quite often I go straight to an event in the evening. So I kind of put my clothes out the night before, and I get really stressed out if I haven't worked out my wardrobe for the next day. But I think the sort of brand Nazy has probably evolved quite a lot over the years. I started working at Sotheby's in 1989, and when I worked at Sotheby's, I probably wore a lot more kind of like suits and trouser suits because I wanted to be taken seriously. And I think that that has evolved over the years. In fact, when I started at Sotheby's, women in the expert divisions were not allowed to wear trousers. And I had bought a series of what I considered as being very smart trouser suits with my from Jigsaw, and I walked in, and a senior colleague told me that I wasn't allowed to wear trousers, so I had to go and see the division head. And well, after my conversation with him, that policy changed in the company, and women were then allowed to wear trousers because I did suggest to Sotheby's that perhaps they could offer me a clothing allowance, and then I could change my wardrobe. So that was quite a big deal in the company at the moment. But I think that, you know, how I dress definitely impacts how I feel on a day-to-day basis.
And how does that change when you are meeting artists, for example?
So artist studios are usually quite cold. I've learned that, you know, from experience. So I always wear like really warm socks and trainers. And if I have to adapt, I'll have a pair of shoes in my bag. I mean, it's silly, but it's all the practical stuff that matter if you're going to be out from like 7:30 a.m. right through to 9, 10 o'clock at night.
And so you change what you wear in a sort of corporate environment to, when you're meeting artists, you have to be...
Yeah, I mean, I do...
Appealing to artists.
Yeah, I mean, the corporate word is an interesting word because in my past roles, I've, you know, sat on boards, etc., quite often being the only kind of executive female sitting on a board. And I definitely did think about what I was wearing to board meetings because I felt very strongly that I wanted my voice to be the hero and not my cleavage. And that is something that you do experience as a sort of a senior executive, if you like, in the world.
Linsey, I wanted to ask you about sort of, you know, because you work with extraordinary artists like Rachel Whiteread, and for the Anthea Hamilton Commission, you worked with Jonathan Anderson, Loewe, you know, do you have key pieces that you always turn to that define your look? You know, are you aware of coming across a certain way when you're working with such creative?
I've got two style icons, which is
Gordon Gekko in Wall Street and Helen Mirren in series 4 of Prime Suspects. Those two looks, I think, are absolute unbeatable. And it's something about being effortlessly in control. So I never like to worry about getting things dirty. I just found some avocado on the sleeve of this, actually. But, you know, I like things that hide the mess of being in a studio or helping an artist by measuring a floor, you know, the things I do on a daily basis. And I am quite lazy, so I don't like anything that can't be washed and dried in my flat, you know, just kind of quite controlled. But the things I would say I'm known for wearing are white shirts and black jeans. That's what I got married in as well. It's my absolute favorite look. And lots of jewelry.
Sounds very practical as well. I mean, you know, obviously when the prize giving is held in London, you're the lead curator of the Turner Prize, you know, and it's a prize that champions such originality of thought and subversion of ideas. And I think, is there pressure to subscribe to that also in the way that you present yourself?
I think curators should always be in the background. The artists are the most important. So I think, and that's not to disrespect people who are much more glamorous than me, because there's a way of pulling that off. I have many colleagues who are very glamorous, but I like to just kind of hide in the background a wee bit. But when you do telly for the first time, that definitely changes your opinion of things. So my first Turner Prize, I did head to toe Isumiaki, and I borrowed a Loewe necklace with a big leather cat. And I loved that outfit so much because I felt like a grown-up. It was very good.
You look back at it every now and then. So yes.
I had to send the necklace back, sadly, but it was amazing.
Perfect, thank you. And Indra, I'd like to hear your perspective. I think, you know, you have many heels, many camps, as it were. You know, you're self an artist, but soon after leaving the RCA, you met the property developer David Roberts, now your husband. You're propelled into the world of collectors. And I wanted to ask you about the expectations that come with being an artist, but also the expectations in the collecting world.
Yeah, that was very kind of quick. I was a bit young and naive, and I didn't really realize what's going to happen. You know, went from Converse to kind of having to go to dinners with other collectors and kind of having front. And but it was a big struggle because, you know, how do you get taken seriously as an artist? And I remember going to big gallery director, and he said, you know, you are too well-dressed to be an artist. And nobody, because I was shown very well at museums, you know, I always had very good following from museums, but I had no commercial success. And I was kind of thinking, but why is that? Of course, marrying one of the biggest collectors in London probably didn't help. So the advice was that I should go down a notch and, you know, get my canvas bag on and the trainers on and get back to be looking like the student artist, you know, which I didn't take. I just thought, you know, if my work can't stand for itself, then it's not strong enough. I should not be judged because I like clothes. And I come from Soviet Union. And in Soviet Union, they had very little, you know, they had very structured uniforms, which were made from like this very dark wool, itchy brown wool, and the only kind of individuality we could have were our collars and cuffs. So the collars and cuffs were like, the, you know, the grandmothers would knit, we would get for Christmas. That was like our individual thing, which would could like, you know, that was it, because in Soviet Union, everyone was the same. So when I came to UK, you know, clothes for me mattered a lot, because that was kind of a way of freedom and individuality. And so, yeah, so it's been a balance, you know. And I didn't listen to the director's advice. I just said, look, I love clothes. I'll wear what I want. I'm young. I want to feel like a female, you know. And luckily, my work stood stronger than the judgments. So
it's difficult, isn't it? Because obviously, as a female, I think you're going to suffer from that a lot more than males ever would. Because I remember, you know, you were telling me about your friend. Was it Ange?
Yeah, Ange Smith. You know, she's not here unfortunately tonight. But Ange was having she's an amazing artist and represented by House on Worth, and was having a big solo show at the House on Worth. And she's a very beautiful woman and young, and she decided to wear high heels and red lipstick to her opening, because why not?
Yeah.
And someone thought she was an assistant, you know, like an intern gallery assistant, you know, which, again, we expect the gallery assistants to look a certain way. So it's, you know, on both sides, you know, she laughed it off. But just because she was wearing lipstick and high heels, she could not be in the artist who the show was about. So, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, is there still this sort of battle to break through those barriers? I mean, there's so much sort of gender stereotyping going on, isn't there?
It is, and it's strange because, you know, female artists for other years, you know, the avant-garde artists in Russia, they design clothes, they wore clothes, you know. Georgia O'Keeffe had her own style and she designed clothes. Frida Kahlo. So, you know, we have a history of female artists who have an amazing style and look like women and were beautiful. So it's very interesting that we still have that way of thinking that the female artist, the way she should look. You know, yeah, I don't know, maybe that will change.
Holly, tell me about your approach, because you have a particularly individual style that you have consciously chosen from early on in your own career.
Is this working? Well, normally I wear a white shirt, and I was very, very lucky to be given this beautiful rust-coloured dress. I wear a white shirt because I was very aware of my father getting up in the morning and putting on a crisp shirt. And it was, he went out to work and he came back in his shirt. And from a very, very little girl, I thought, I'm going to be like that. And I kind of subconsciously, I didn't want to be a man going out to work, but it was my uniform. It's not just a white shirt, it's now made for me in Paris. I'm very lucky, I have a gallery in Paris and I found a little man who makes shirts for me, and they have funny buttons and cuffs and I always have great earrings. But I was thinking, why the white shirt? And I think it probably is to do with watching my dad going out to work, you know, looking crisp and coming back looking crisp. So I think I always want to look very crisp, and it's also, I can't look as expensively dressed as my collectors. It's an absolute no-no. Although I would love to wear fabulously expensive clothes all day long, I can't. Because if I'm selling to Mr. and Mrs. Billionaire, and she's always going to be dressed wonderfully, if I have a more expensive pair of shoes or handbag or the latest Celine shirt, it doesn't go down really well. So actually at the weekends, I dress really well. I buy really expensive things for the weekends when I'm not with the clients. So when I'm in the country, you'll see me in my Celine shoes and everything. Yes, but anyway, it's lovely to wear your clothes, and I may change into a rust-coloured shirt, I think, next week. Thank you.
You have about sort of 90, don't you? 90 shirts. Or have you had the
90
120. Made? 120 shirts, yeah. Okay. And how do you keep them in a...
in a rather beautiful closet, cupboard, and I'm actually really good at ironing, and I have a little iron with me when I go travelling. It's really sad, but I pack all my suitcases with tissue paper. I travel a lot this year. Well, every month I'm on about 17 flights, and the first thing I do, whatever happens, I will unpack my suitcase, and I'll iron my shirts for the next day. It's really pathetic, and I don't trust hotel laundry, because it's expensive and not very good. So there I am, I'll come back from an event and I will iron my shirt for the next day. And I've also got a funny story about creases. When, as a very young art dealer, I was sent to a big collection in Denver, these extraordinary collectors who were opening their art barn. And I flew overnight, I was there for 1 hour, literally 1 hour, and I was staying with the collectors. And I unpacked my white shirt, and it was really crumpled, and I didn't have an iron. And I remember my mum saying, you can get creases out of clothes if you hang them in your shower. So I put the shower on really hot in my lovely ensuite, beautiful room. I put the shower on super hot, and I put my white shirt up there, and all the wrinkles came out, but so did the fire alarm. Because of the steam in the room, set off the fire alarm throughout the entire mansion and the art barn. And the fire brigade actually came up from the city because of my shirt. So be careful.
Yeah. Good tip. I wanted to talk about the idea of sexuality. You know, as we were discussing yesterday, Polly, you know, the art world is full of visually aware people. you know, is it necessary in this day and age to desexualize yourself using clothes, following on from your white shirt point?
No, because I always have a bit of flesh showing. No, I think it's all about being appropriate and making people feel at ease, particularly for me. I'm in the service industry. I sell. I have to make people feel comfortable, but I'm also aware of my allure, and I hate to use that word, but we all have it. Women have it in bagfuls, and we should use it. And whatever that is, whether it's the twinkle in your eye or the shape of your cheekbones or the gloss of your hair, you are all alluring, and that will help you. And I don't think it needs to be mean you're being overtly sexual, but use what you have.
Tell me about what you heard from a headhunter. Because it was quite shocking.
And my jaw very shocking. Heard, yes. And I heard, and it wasn't actually a British headhunter, it was an American headhunter who were going through the criteria, the list of characteristics or skills or plus points they were looking for when they were recruiting female executives. And one of them, apart from, you know, experience and skills, was your erotic value, your erotic charge. And I was really shocked by that. But it's actually, and I don't know which headhunting firm this is, but right down at the bottom of the boxes you would tick, they would give you a little 9 out of 10 or 2 out of 10 on your erotic charge, I think they called it. So, which was, I don't think that would happen now. This was, I mean, I've been in the art world 30 years, and I think this was definitely 30 years ago, but it's it was a depressing thought.
Nazy, have you ever sort of experienced anything? I mean, you've been on the front line of having to sort of sell, and yeah, have you ever experienced anything like that?
It's interesting because that, in a way, can I just ask a question? Was that directed at anyone applying, or do you think it was a female question?
I think it was female.
Yeah. Okay. So, so when I started at Sotheby's, we would say that 99% of the people in the executive roles were male, and all the females were in support roles, and it was a nice little industry to get into for your daughter. You know, the art world, it wasn't professionalized at all in that way. And there's always been sexism, if you like, within the workplace. Whether it's implied or explicit, it is something that I wouldn't be alone to say yes, I've experienced it. Implied could be something like you're the only female executive in a room, and everyone starts talking about cricket or dog racing, which has happened to me, and I'm afraid I don't know anything about either of those. And explicit, it can be all sorts of things whereby you know that if you were male for asking for things for your team or for yourself, you might be regarded as dynamic and go-getting. Whereas as female, you know, you get told that you're being aggressive and emotional. So I think there are different levels that we've probably all experienced as we've gone up the corporate ladder.
Turn to the idea of self-expression and personal branding, because when I think about a situation where presentations matter, like art fairs come to mind, because they are in themselves visual spectacles, and having attended, you know, Frieze Week and Fashion Weeks, they're not actually that different sometimes. When I think about people like the gallerist Maureen Paley, who always has her, you know, back comb and always in black, and because of her eyelid that falls when cameras flash, you know, she always wears dark glasses, and she uses that for her own advantage. And I think she's developed her image from her own personal brand, and it's an extension of who she is, because her office is always really neat and everything is orthogonal. And I think as a client, you know, you would trust that she would get things that way as well. And so I'd love to know from each of you whether you subscribe to the idea of a personal brand. Maybe I can start with you, Linsey.
Definitely, but I think it comes, I was obviously thinking a lot about clothes because of this, and I have certain rules about things that I would just never breach. So like we were saying, I never wear pattern, I never wear stripes, I only wear natural fabrics. Like I've got really, I don't like when clothes in your wardrobe don't match. That really upsets me when they're kind of hanging in a particular way. So I think it's less that I've chosen to have a particular kind of brand, but it's definitely something that kind of occurs. And I think also in the arts, you're always kind of fighting for attention, even if you don't think you are. You know, even if you are super collegiate of your female colleagues, which I always endeavor to be, there always is still a bit of, you know, jostling for kind of who's doing what project or who, you know, is doing talks and events and things like that. So I think there's something in an industry that is so crowded, full of absolutely amazing, talented women, you kind of feel like you want to match up to that as well.
And, you know, Indre, you know, obviously, you grew up in Palanga, Lithuania, which was, as you said, then in the Soviet Union. And you've previously spoken about how you had to be careful about what you said, how free expression was curbed in your art class. But you've also said that the roots of the place one is born are forever in one's soul. So what do you take from your past that and from your Lithuanian heritage that has affected your own self-expression?
I would definitely say I'm very schizophrenic in my fashion. So I have this roots of like structure, and I would love to structure, but then I have this rebellion side where I go for the florals and anything pretty, and, you know, because that was something I really wanted to be as a child. But, you know, so I definitely struggle with both sides, the Western side of me and the kind of very Soviet side of me, you know. And I'm very jealous of people when I hear that they have a proper uniform, because in deep down, this is where, you know, that's where my roots come from. But I definitely, and it changes, you know. So I'm in the studio, and then I have to go dinners. I definitely go now for easy, something that doesn't crease, which I travel a lot, so I have to have non-creasing, something that matches everything. So my I need a travel iron or really hot shower. Yeah, great. I'll get some tips. But, you know, just something easy, also not heavy. I found that, like, sometimes you buy heavy things and it's not traveling appropriate at all. You know, you don't want to be weighing half of your suitcase. And then so recently I became a mom, so that's kind of thrown me completely, you know, what I can wear and I cannot wear. And so it's a really, I think you evolve as you grow up, as you, you know, as your family grows or whatever happens. So yeah, it's interesting. I think clothes definitely are part of you, you know.
And I wanted to sort of pick up on the sort of international side, because you're all relatively very well traveled. And, you know, Polly, I know that different markets have different visual currency, don't they? And your experience with an American gallery seems to show that there were different sort of dress requirements.
Yes, quite interesting. Working for a big, I opened up a big American gallery in London, and a big American brand, and I'm not going to tell the name, but I'd come from a very English gallery, and they asked me to be part of the opening team, and they said to me, you know, Polly, it's really important you tell your team when we have a private view they can only wear black. And I looked at this, my boss, and I said, we're in London. There is no way you can tell your team to wear black. And he said, but this is an American corporation, and it's really important they all look the same. And I had a really big row with him, but I won. And I said, you know, this is going to be the gallery in London. I'm not going to give the name, but this will be the your London branch, and we have our very individual styles. So anyway, I won, and we ended up looking like English eccentrics, and he's still moaning about it. But thank goodness trainers are now fashionable and workwear, and I think everyone I know in the art world is okay to wear trainers. But it used to be wear black and wear high heels.
I get the feeling we can get away with a bit more because we're British, actually. You know, and I was interested by what you were saying about wearing natural fabrics, because given that we're all sort of becoming increasingly concerned about the environment, have you all become sort of more ethically conscious shoppers, do you think? Was it still difficult just because of the pace of your jobs? Maybe I'll start with you.
Well, I have a 20-year-old daughter who's very, very conscious of the climate and ethical issues, and I think that has probably had the biggest impact on me, and I really believe that sustainable clothing is really important because we need fresh air and we need to protect our natural resources. So it's definitely something that I've become a lot more aware of than I may have been even like 3 or 4 years ago. What I don't really fully appreciate, not being in the sort of fashion industry, is what ethical truly, truly means. You know, in my mind, it's using less water, wasting less resources, and treating your staff well. But I I'm not going to pretend I know exactly what it means, but I'm definitely more conscious of it. Yes.
Indre.
Yeah, I mean, you know, there was a story recently that a big brand burns all their things that they don't sell, you know, and it was kind of like a story which went, and it was yesterday, you know, next day was the chip and fish and chips paper, and nobody really took notice. But for me, that was definitely, definitely would never buy from a brand. And I'm very much like that. I don't really know what they mean. You know, I know that to make cotton t-shirt and jeans, you know, you have to use 22,000 liters of water to just make one pair of jeans and one pair of t-shirts. So that is unbelievable, you know, and that's also for organic cotton. So it's been, I think the education is not there yet. I think there's a lot of, I think people are making a lot of money from saying that it's ecological, and, you know, so I feel like there needs to be real kind of information, really, because I feel as blind as I felt 5 years ago. But definitely there are brands who I know who burn things instead of putting them in sale. I don't buy from anymore. Fine.
I do want to leave time for questions, so I thought I would sort of talk about practical fashion before we move to questions. The director of Sotheby's, Helena Newman, says that auctioneering is about theatre, and your outfit is an outfit that helps performance. So I'd love to know from each of you your, I think we actually know something already, your fail-safe piece, all pieces that gets you from morning to night in which you can face any situation. Polly, I don't even know whether I should ask you.
Okay, I definitely, I could not live without my pyjamas. It's not fail-safe, it was one of those things as a child, you came home from school, you got your wool dress off, and you went into your pyjamas. So that's, for me, that's my fault. You know, I feel at home, I feel relaxed, so my PJs go wherever with me.
Lindsay. Oh, and what brand?
Any brand. I'm not picky. I have a lot, I have a big collection.
What material?
Silk. Yeah.
Good to know. Lindsay?
I think, yeah, white shirt, black jeans, but also scent. I really like, I'm a bit obsessive about scent. My favourite is really accessible, Hermès de Terre, Man's Cologne.
Yeah.
But there's, I've tried, my friend's a perfume historian, so she's been trying to make me branch out into Frederick Malle and all these really expensive brands, but nothing's as good as Hermès. It's so distinctive. So those kind of accents to a basic outfit.
And also that's very transportative, isn't it? You know,
yes,
wherever you
absolutely.
Are.
Absolutely. 80s Manhattan.
Nazy?
I was like a good dress. I love a good dress. And I think I wear a lot of ankle boots. I think that's one of my signature things. And I always wear lips, they call lip gloss. I think if I didn't have anything else, I'd have to have them.
And do you feel like it's armor, or do you feel like it's just part of who you are?
I think it's a little bit of both. I think the whole getting ready every day is partly who I am, but it's also partly getting me ready for that day. And unlike Polly, if you see me at the weekend, I've usually got tracksuit bottoms on and sweatshirts. And so, you know, I definitely do have a working wardrobe or a week wardrobe.
Fantastic. Well, thank you so much, Indre, Linsey, Nazy and Polly. I'm sure everyone here found your words as enlightening and interesting as I did. And I hope you will all harness the power of your own image for the festive season and beyond. Thank you very much. Any questions, then put your hand up maybe, and then we can get a microphone to you.
When I told some of my colleagues I was coming to this in our Monday morning huddle, they said they wouldn't have the confidence to come to something like this. They don't have the budget because they're maybe junior team members. And so I said I'd ask, you know, if you have a low budget, how do you take part in this brand building through your image? And maybe pass on the advice.
Is that to everyone? Yeah.
Yes, or anyone.
I'm happy to start. I'm public sector, always have been, and working class, absolutely, from the north of Scotland. So it's definitely not about money, because I still don't have any. So I think it's about finding shapes that suit you, and you can get them in any brand. And about being saving up and not buying one piece that you love and then wearing that forever, because you've got a uniform so you can, because no one will notice. And I love that you have 120 shirts. That's my favorite thing. That's my aspiration now, is to have that wardrobe.
You're really old and great
now. So good. It's just so classy. But also to use things like Vestiaire. I don't know if that's how you say it. Yeah, where I get a lot of stuff, and eBay and things like that. And just style it out, like just attitude mostly, I think.
Yeah. There's some really good peer-to-peer websites, yeah, aren't they, at the moment, like, yeah, Depop and Vassegh.
Yeah. Yeah, that's it.
Thank you. Fashion, I think, is fantastic. And House of Zara, and are we allowed to mention other names? And we say House of Zara, or we say Tosho, you know what that is, or my favourite is Ash and M. And, you know, those places, you can always get something fantastic. And yeah, and I think you're right. You can look very up to date with a new silhouette. Mm. Doesn't have to be the newest Edeline Lee, but it, you know, I'm sure some people are following your silhouette. And I don't think fashion, I think style doesn't have to be expensive. And I think we're all about style here, and tell your staff to find their individual style.
I think you can't buy style. You know, I think sometimes the more money you have, the less style you have. So, because you just... Definitely.
It was interesting what you said as well, that you actually can never compete. Because if you're working with, you know, obviously I'm a little bit different in the clients and people that I meet, but I do work with high-level patrons who are extraordinary people and look incredible, and there's literally no point trying because they just look so good that you just kind of have to stick to your guns about the thing. I remember Rachel Whiteread, who I love, who has a uniform of Margaret Howell, and she was making fun of me because I was going through an Issey Miyake phase wearing it every day, and Anne Gallagher, one of her best friends, just saying, "Leave her alone, it suits her." It's like, thank you, Anne.
Helena, this isn't a question, but it's a related point. Vintage. We haven't talked about vintage.
Yes.
In response to that question Selena asked. I mean, I am a vintage obsessive, and I was in vintage throughout all my art school years. And at some point, I had to tone it down because it looked a bit Bette Midler. But I think vintage is something we should explore.
Yeah, absolutely. I think Jo's absolutely right. We should be mining from all of our mother's cupboards, and you know,
I mean, I some of my first work clothes were from my mum's cupboard, and I still go to her cupboard, and she's got some fantastic 1970s and 1980s pieces that I still wear today. But I think the other thing is that I mean, for me, I'm a bit of a hoarder. My husband says that I keep things in case they come back in fashion, and that's actually true. They do. And I, you know, I don't like to throw anything away. So I think, you know, you just mix things up, and vintage is a really good way of doing that.
And if I buy pieces now, I kind of tell myself they're for my two daughters, it's their inheritance.
I don't buy clothes by season. I buy clothes that I love and wear them again and again and over the years.
I have bought clothes from a season and not worn it for a few years, because I didn't want to be, you know, wearing the same thing that everyone else has. And it does work, actually. You can buy things and not wear them and then bring them out 2 years later and be as fresh, you know, it's because people do go through kind of fashions, and you don't, sometimes you don't want to be the same as everyone else.
And then 20 years later.
It's amazing. Even better, with few more falls.
There's a microphone just there.
Starting out in my career, I'm a master's student in the art world, and I was wondering how your styles has developed over your careers, and if it has developed, where you found your tips and tricks from in developing the sense of who you are in the art world. And this is to anyone who wants to answer.
I can start.
Yeah.
When I first started out, I thought I had to look professional. I thought that was a certain way. And really that was so that I would be noticed and taken seriously. I think as time has gone on, I've probably developed my own inner confidence. And so I don't really wear the corporate sort of suit attire that I used to wear at the beginning. I think it just kind of happens over time.
Yeah, I think it's, just don't let the clothes wear you. You know, I think really if you're going to any meeting or anything, as long as you feel super confident, you are looking great. You know, it's whatever you wear, but it's the confidence which will shine through in the end. When you try and be someone else and you try and put clothes on that you think someone else expected, is when you kind of go wrong, really. So for a young student like yourself, I think you just have to trust in yourself and feel good.
And also, there must be one part of your face or your hair or your body you feel you particularly love, and make that the best it can be. So if you've got beautiful eyes, invest in some really, we'll buy some great glittery gold, apparently, eyeshadow. Keep your hair as shiny as you can or as kept as you can. I think it's nice. I think you need to look kind of quite well turned out, not in an old-fashioned way, but look well presented and clean. But I think try and find a sort of style thing, whether it's, she's the girl with the great rings, or she's the girl with fantastic eyes, or she always has amazing shoes, you know. You always have amazing white shirts, and I have really great grey shirts. But try and find one thing, and then that becomes your own, I don't want to use the word brand, but that becomes your sort of style signifier.
I wanted to touch on the subject again that you already raised about the travel wardrobe. So thinking about things that say when you go to biennials or art fairs and, you know, you're pacing or, you know, you're doing a lot of walking in the day and maybe going to events at night. So Polly, I love this idea of you with the white shirt. However, I'm really, really hoping I'm not the only woman in the room who's going to say this, but I cannot iron. And I've been very blessed that I've always gone out with men who thankfully can, but I don't always have them on hand.
I was going to say,
do you have tips for things that are not always dependent on an iron, that are good things to travel and fit in a suitcase where you're, say, going away for a long time, but you only have a limited sort of wardrobe to bring for everyone?
Quite a good question.
Quite difficult, that, because they tend to be a bit body conscious. Things that you don't iron are tight, apart from this wonderful dress. Thank you very much.
We obviously...
We have made our brand on dressing the art world because they do travel so much. All of our fabrics resist wrinkling. But I have one tip that's perhaps sustainable as well. When you get those dry cleaners, plastic black bags, which are unbelievably not biodegradable, even the ones that say they are, you need to dispose of them in specific places that don't exist in our boroughs. Those bags are amazing for packing your clothes. So if you lay one flat and fold it neatly in one of those bags and then fold your clothes as little as possible, you'll find that you wrinkle less.
I actually do that. I have a good one, though, which is grey cashmere roll necks, Uniqlo, charcoal grey, men's extra large, gold earrings. It's like the perfect, and it never creases.
Uniqlo cashmere.
Yeah.
Right. Uniqlo cashmere is amazing.
Yeah.
I do a very naughty thing where I go shopping. You'll see me in the corner taking a dress like that and crushing it. And then I let it go. If it crushes, I will never buy it. So then I know. So if you go shopping and you see like a corner of all the clothes crush, it's me. That's a way to test the how well it's going to travel.
And this is the back. There's
a question at the back.
When you prepare for events and different, do you internally dialogue, and what would your internal preparation be? Do you have a practice? And that can be to anyone.
I'm an off-the-cuff person. I'm an off-the-cuff person. I stand up and do speeches, and they're probably always wrong. And, you know, I don't prepare at all. I have very small memory. So I just let it go, I guess, whatever happens. Would love to be.
I'm a terrible planner, and I down to the last detail. But I do definitely, I always give myself a talk in the morning, and like, you know, this is what I'm going to wear, and I'm going to be this person, I'm going to close that deal, and I'm going to make that happen. So you talk about an internal dialogue. Is that about what you're going to wear or how you're going to get through the day?
Both. I think...
I'm always talking
to
myself.
So your preparation for what your day looks like and what you choose to wear or be, I just wonder what you look to prepare for that.
Mentally?
Yeah.
Yeah. So I visualise my day. And I also talk to myself. And I visualize what I'm going to go through and what, not different characters, but what requirements it will be, you know, will be required of me that day. And then I feel prepared. I don't ever just walk into somewhere and not think about it. It could be anything from an art fair to a lunch to speaking to a gallery or a client. I don't just, it's not spontaneous. And I smile. I think smiling helps.
Yeah,
smiling
is quite key.
I think I'm missing out here. Yes, no. I mean, for work, I plan everything, of course. You would never do anything unprepared. But other than that, I think I need to get on this imagining the day scenario. I know. I just roam about.
I think I visualize my work, so I think I don't have time to visualize, you know, like everything I visualize is about what I'm going to make and what I'm, so for me, I think that's what takes up my space. Everything else is just fitting in, so that probably that's why.
I think that's all we have time for, Faye, but thank you so much for your questions. Kate's going to wrap up for us.
Very, very quickly, and saying thank you to our amazing panel. I can't think of a single discussion that has covered Gordon Gekko and Bette Midler, and I can honestly say I have learned from each of you, so thank you. Also, Helena, I think I would listen to you moderate anything anywhere, so many, many thanks for doing this this evening. But also, it's a quick end of year to our members in the room and to our executive committee members and our founding members and our members. For supporting us and for the 3 years that we've actually had with you. And I know you've all heard me say this before, but you really do make AWITA what it is. So thank you. Go meet, mingle. A big thank you to Edeline and to Fenwick as well. And a couple of housekeeping notes. Do please sign up for the newsletter if you're a guest in the room and you want to hear more about our AWITA events. Also, please do send us your news. We do like including it. I'm going to save a fond farewell to Alex, who's leaving us, but for far countries. And also, on behalf of the co-founders, a healthy, happy new year, and we look forward to seeing you in 2020. So do keep an eye on the newsletters.
I was glad to start.